I'm going to start the session. So my session is divided into two parts. The first part is of sampling methods, and the second part is of sample size determination. So when we talk about the sampling, so the first rule of sampling is that we collect the sample and examine the hypothesis. So in this process, we take the data from the sample, but we examine the hypothesis for the population. So we study the sample, but conclude the population. The whole story of sampling depend upon this statement. So we collect the sample, we collect the data of the sample, and conclude about the population. So all the hypothesis testing is for conclusion about the population. So it is just like that. So when you taste a sabzi, vegetable dish. So if you say that namak, the salt is okay, it means in whole vegetable the salt is okay. So conclusion is for the complete population. So in population, there are three things. There are three levels in population. Number one, general population. Number two, target population. And number three is sample. So we have to understand what is the difference between the three. Number one, the population is always the people, patient, right, or anybody on which the conclusion applicable. So anybody on which your conclusion is applicable is known as population. Like for example, if I am saying that I am going to study the online shoppers, right, then the study may be applicable of anyone who is in Europe, who is in China, who is in Africa, who is shopping to online, right? But I feel very bad when I saw the title that the study of online shopper online shopping in Bareilly, the study of online shopping in Muradabad. Are, actually this is not the population. Population is means anybody who is doing that. So this is one of the mistakes that people misunderstand the population and the target population. So population is anyone. Because theory we never build the theory for Muradabad, for Bareilly, for Jaipur. No, theory is for everyone, right? So if we, whatever contribute we contribute in the theory, it is for everyone in the world, right? So population is everybody. Population means anybody who on which your conclusion are applicable. Now target population. So if this is the population, then what is target population? Target population is the population which is under your approach. For example, if I am living in Delhi, I can contact, because before Corona, normally we take the printout of the questionnaire and we go to the different places and fill the questionnaire. But now we are doing it with the help of Google Form. So the question is that whom you can approach. I can easily approach the people who are living in India. I can easily approach who are residing in Delhi NCR. Right, so this is my approachable population, the population which I approach. Suppose I am studying the teachers studying in the university. So I have to think that in which place I can go. Like one of the scholars is doing, the topic is that why farmers are adopting the organic products. So the question is that which farmers he can approach. So because he is living in Pune, so she can meet the farmers who are in nearby areas. So this is the target population. Normally, the candidates who are doing PhD in Delhi NCR, their target population is Delhi NCR. And I have seen that those who are doing PhD in Punjab, so their target population is Punjab, like that. So those who are residing in Mumbai, their target population is Mumbai and Maharashtra. So the target population is that population which is under your approach, and you can go and you can collect the data from there. So this is a subset of the population. So target population is the subset of the population. And within the target population, you pick your sample. So sample is again subset of the target population. So you can see that the population is the broad and target population is the subset of the population, and sample is the subset of the target population. So we should understand the three concepts in such a way. And the element is the person, element is the company, element is the patient, from where you are collecting the data. So from whom you are collecting the data is the element. Now the whole process of the sampling is that this is your population. Assume that this is your population, and this population, the you are calculating the mean, and mean is represented by the mu. So anything which we are calculating from the population is called mu. It may be hypothetical, it may be real. And in most of the cases, it is hypothetical, because it is just impossible to calculate the values of the population, because population is infinite. We cannot have the data of the population. And this is a small sample. And whatever we measure from this sample is called sample statistic. So there are two terms. One is the statistic, and second is the parameter. And parameter is something which is related to the population. If you are calculating the mean, variance, or anything of the population, this is called parameter. A statistic is something which is calculated for the sample. And normally, we calculate the statistic from the sample, we calculate the values of the sample, and examine the hypothesis. And then we conclude about the population, and this process is known as statistical inference. This procedure is known as statistical inference. So statistical inference is the process of concluding the population on the basis of the sample, right? So whatever we are concluding, we are not concluding for the target population, we are not concluding for the sample, we are concluding what population, right? So that's why I always say that don't put the area of your target population in the title of the thesis or in the paper, because your objective is to compute the population, not the sample of the target population. And this process is known as inferencing. Now, there are a few things which I want to tell you, that how the statistical inferencing will be accurate. So is there any condition? Is there any condition then where we can say the statistical inference is accurate? Yes, there are conditions. The condition number one is that your sample should be normally distributed. The variables which you are collecting from the sample should be normally distributed. Only then you can apply the parametric test in the sample and conclude about the population. The second is that your sample should be large. Now, here there is a very important concept come. So what is the meaning of large sample? So when I say that your sample should be large, so that the process of sampling inference should be accurate. What is the definition of large? In many books, it is mentioned that when your sample size is more than 30, it is a large sample. No, I am just totally against of that, because sample is said to be large only when it is normally distributed. The statistic only say that when your sample size is more than 30, it tends to be normal. Whether it is a normal or not normal, it is not 100% sure. The only statistics only found that by doing so many simulations, that the statisticians found that after the sample size of 30, the distribution tends to be normal, but it is not compulsory that it will be normal. So you have to check. You have to check whether the distribution of your variables is normal or not. So that is one of the key part of the sampling design, that if your sample size is normal, you can say my sample is large sample. And if your sample size is skewed or non-normally distributed, then you cannot say my sample is large. So this is one of the key. And in most of the foreign universities, it is compulsory to show that whether your sample is normally distributed or not. So whether the distribution of the variables is normal or not, it is compulsory to report. Although in most of the research papers, I do not found any test where they prove it by that my distribution is normal, but they say that we examine the data is normal. Okay. And so this is the process of statistical inference, and this statistical inference should be accurate, and it is only possible when your sampling selection is good, is better. So I hope you understand what is the meaning of the statistics, what is the meaning of the parameter, and what is the meaning of statistical inference. Then normally there are two types of studies in the research: census survey and sample survey. And I know that nobody can do census surveys. As a researcher, it is just impossible to do census survey. It is just impossible. If I ask you why it is impossible to conduct the census survey, the answer is that at least you need many years to complete it. So time period is very high. Second, a lot of manpower is required. So a lot of manpower is required. You cannot do it alone. If you have the manpower of more than 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 3 lakh, then only you can do it. Otherwise, not possible. So that's why when the Indian government is conducting the census survey, they take the help of all primary teachers, all teachers in the India. So then they are able to complete the census survey. And not only teachers, there are so many Anganwadi workers and all. So they are taking the help of that. And the third, a lot of money is involved. So as a researcher, we should know that we cannot do a census survey because it is just impossible. But we can do sample survey and we are doing that. Now the question is that the sampling study should give you the accurate result. This is the objective. Whatever study we are doing on the sample, the result will be on the result will be applicable on the population, and they should be accurate. Okay. And there are three laws. These three laws explains how we can get the better results, accurate results in the sampling survey. So these three laws are, the first law is central limit theorem. The central limit theorem say that if you increase the sample size, the sampling distribution tends to be normal. The distribution of the sample becomes normal. And after a certain sample size, it is normal. So the central limit theorem gives you one solution. If your distribution is not normal, that increase your sample size, and increase your sample size to that extent that the distribution will be normal. The law of large numbers say that if you keep on increasing the sample size, the accuracy of the result will be high. So you will get more accurate results if you increase the sample size. So this is one of the concepts. The difference between first and second is that the first is talk about the distribution, and second law of large number talk about the accuracy of the sampling inference. Similarly, the law of random selection. The law of random selection say that if you pick the sampling units randomly, if you pick the sampling units randomly, your results are highly accurate. Your results are accurate. And if the sample selection is not random, so that's why in most of the cases, we don't write that we do convenience sampling and easy sampling, right? Most of the time, we want to prove that we did random sampling because we want to show that whatever result we are drawing are accurate. So these are the three laws which guides you to get the better sampling inference. So statistical inference will be accurate if you keep these three laws in your mind. Now, in most of the cases and papers, it is mandatory, compulsory. I'm saying compulsory, not optional, compulsory, to define your sampling process. So I call it sampling design. So we write the heading sampling design. And in this sampling design, we define five steps. So these five steps are, we define the population, that who comes in our population. Then what is the target population? And what is the sampling frame of the target population? Then after deciding the sampling frame, then we decide whether which sampling technique we should adopt. And if there is no sampling frame, we cannot go for the random sampling. And if sampling frame is available, so we can go for random sampling. So the question is that the sampling frame is available or not. And after deciding the sampling technique, we define our sample size. And we justify the sample size. If you don't give justification, your thesis will come back. Remember it. So now I'm going to teach you the different stages. Let me explain one by one. So population, I already explained you. Anyone where your the results are applicable is the population. Now the concept of target population. So we let's say I belong to Delhi. My target population is Delhi NCR. If you belong to Jaipur, maybe your target population is Jaipur, Ajmer and nearby areas. If anybody belong to Mumbai, so the target population is Maharashtra. Now the question is that, do you have the data of the target population? I'm giving you many examples here because this is very important. In one scholar was doing PhD, and the population are the faculty members teaching in MBA colleges only. So the scholar was collecting the data only from the faculty members who is teaching in MBA colleges. So he wrote in the target population that faculty members teaching in the MBA colleges in Maharashtra or in Mumbai. Let's say we say Mumbai and Pune. So he decided to collect the data from the faculty members who are teaching in MBA colleges in Mumbai and Pune. Now the question is that do we have the details of these faculty members? Is there any list? Is there any source which is available and tells you that these are the faculty members comes in your target population? Right? The answer is yes. Almost every MBA colleges, they disclose the faculty members who are teaching in their colleges. So we have the sampling frame, right? Similarly, if you say, I want to collect the data from the bank managers who are working with the private banks like HDFC and ICICI Bank and located in Delhi NCR, their branch should locate in Delhi NCR. So the question is that, do you have the list? Yes, we have the list. So in the website, it is mentioned that what are the different branches of the HDFC Bank, what are the different branches of ICICI Bank, and their contact number and all details are available. So in some cases, the sampling frame is available. In some cases, the sampling frame is available. If I ask you, do you have the list of the small medium companies in your area? Answer is yes, because there are so many websites where the information is given. Now the question is that if you have the sampling frame, can you do the random sampling? Answer is yes, because you are having sampling frame. You can apply the random sampling method. You can apply the lottery method. You can apply the systematic random sampling method. But the problem is that in more than 90% of the cases, sampling frame is not available. I'm telling you, because if I ask you that, do you have the details of the customers who are doing the online shopping? Do you have the sampling frame of that? Answer is no. Do you have the sampling frame of the customers who are using the Dell laptop or the HP laptop in your area? Answer is no. You cannot have the list. Do you know the details of the customers who are using the mobile phone? Answer is no. So whenever we conduct the techniques or research, like one of my friend is doing research on the e-hailing apps, might, like for example Ola and Uber. So we were discussing. So I was asking the person, so do you have all the list of customers who are using Ola and Uber? He said no. So then I said that how can you apply the random sampling? So random sampling is not applicable here. So sampling frame is one of the key which decides whether the sampling technique you will use in the study. So sampling frame, what is sampling frame? By definition, is the sampling frame can be defined as the list or the source available about the details of the target population. In some cases, the sampling frame is available. For example, if somebody say me, sir, I want to do a research on cancer patients in Delhi. So here the list is available because all the cancer patients take the medicine from the cancer hospitals. And in Delhi, we are having 3 or 4 cancer hospitals and we can get the list from there if it is possible. But possibility is there. So first of all, you have to find out whether the sampling frame is available in your study or not. And if the sampling frame is not available, I can guarantee you cannot apply the random sampling. Only the Juha type you can do only. Because I have found that the scholars say, sir, I decided the days in the week randomly. I decided the month days in the month randomly. Then I go to the different malls randomly. So this is not a random sampling, right? Just saying that I'm doing randomly, no, it is not a random sampling. So random sampling means when you have the complete list of the candidates or the target population and you apply a scientific method of selecting the people randomly, right? So you have to understand the importance of sampling frame. Okay, now sampling frame, I already explained you, it is the list, and this is the list of the people in the target population, elements in the target population, and on the basis of the sampling frame, you will decide your sampling design. Okay, now we are coming to the sampling process. And before going to the slide, one thing I just want to conclude, that if you have the sampling frame, you adopt the random sampling method or probability sampling method. And if you do not have the sampling frame, you cannot do the random sampling. This is a statistical conclusion. Okay, now there are two types of sampling methods, the probability sampling method and the non-probability sampling method. There are two types of sampling methods. And the condition, I already told you that when we can go for random sampling method and the condition where we cannot go for random sampling method. And if you are not able to go for probability sampling methods, you have to adopt non-probability sampling methods. The process of drawing the sample from the population, target population, is known as the sampling process. So I will define each and every process. So first is the convenience sampling. And unfortunately, 90% of the scholars do only convenience sampling. So whether they write purposive sampling, judgmental sampling, quota sampling, or whatever sampling they write, but in fact, it is convenience sampling. So convenience sampling means jo mil gaya. So whosoever is available, take the data from there. So this is convenience sampling. And in today's world, most of the researchers are using the Google form. And they are saying that it is purposive sampling or it is the snowball sampling. Actually, it is convenience sampling. Because you are sending to those who are available to you. You will send the Google form to only those persons who are available to you. So in other words, actually, it is a convenience sampling. It is another form of convenience sampling. So convenience sampling means whosoever is available, whosoever is there nearby in your nearby areas, or anybody who is in your approach, if you are collecting from there, this is nothing but a convenience sampling. It is the easiest sampling, and 90% of the scholars are doing the convenience sampling. Okay. So let's in this picture, suppose you are the person who is having the red shirt, and these are the possible target population, but there are three people near you, so you take the data from there. So this is your sample. It's known as convenience sampling. And the after convenience sampling, there is a sampling called judgmental sampling. It is also known as purposive sampling, because in judgmental sampling or purposive sampling, I'm telling you why I'm saying that it is judgmental and purposive, because in some PhD seminars, I found that the judge is saying that the panel member saying it is a purposive sampling. The scholar say that it is a judgmental sampling. So both of them are right, and they don't know that judgmental sampling is known as purposive sampling. So that's why I'm telling you. So purposive sampling and judgmental sampling are same, similar. Only thing in judgmental sampling and purposive sampling is that you selected a criteria. So if somebody is fulfilling the criteria, I will collect the data. If somebody is not fulfilling the criteria, I will not fill it. Like, for example, a questioner comes to me and the question is that which model of Mercedes car you are having. So because I don't have Mercedes car, so I keep it blank, right? So there is the option that I don't have. I clicked on that I don't have. So I do not know what is the purpose of this question, but actually this is a qualifying question. So they will collect the data from only those people who are having the Mercedes car. I'm just giving you one example. Or suppose I ask you that which platform you are using for online teaching, and I give blank, 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 or give you some options, or the last option is that I do not use online platform. So it means if you are using this any online platform, I will keep you in the sampling. If you are not using it, I will not. So there are many qualifying questions. Like, for example, how much teaching experience you have? And if the person say I'm having teaching experience for 4 years, and my criteria is that I will collect all the data from only those students or those candidates who have at least 5 year teaching experience. It means anybody who is having the teaching experience less than 5 years, I will not keep that person in my sampling sample. So there are some qualifying questions, and they are not disclosed that this is a qualifying question. They are the part of the questionnaire, but the person who is filling it is not know that this is a qualifying question. So we insert some qualifying questions and ask them to fill the questionnaire. And if they qualify our condition, then we will take the data and keep it in the sample. Otherwise, we remove the person from the list. So this is the judgmental sampling. Judgmental sampling is one of the most used sampling in the research. in PSD. And why I also support the judgmental sampling, because random sampling you cannot do. And you are unknowingly doing convenience sampling, so better you go for judgmental. So judgmental sampling is better method, because you are putting the filters. Only those people who are satisfying the filters can come in your sample. So that's why the judgmental sampling is much better. So it is a purposive sampling. You can see in the picture, those persons who are satisfying the criteria will come into the sample. Okay. Now after that, we have quota sampling. So what is the concept of quota sampling? Quota sampling is that sometimes in life we found that the percentages are not equal. Like for example, in teaching profession, nowadays we are having 80% females and 20% males. And when the moment when I joined the teaching, so I started with teaching MBA. So in my time, the male faculties were more and female faculties were less. But now the female faculties are 90%, 80%, 70%, not less than that. And females are more. So when we decided to collect the data from the gender of the faculties, so we have to take the ratio of 60, 40 or 70, 30. Okay, in this example, you may not believe. So I'm giving you another example. In most of the colleges, if you visit, you found that 70% of the faculties are assistant professor, 20% of them are associate professor, and 5 to 10% are professor. And I hope you cannot deny this. And in the private colleges, the conditions are more worse. I know many colleges, private colleges, where 100% of the faculties are assistant professor. So the management do not like to have professors. It is very, very true in Delhi and nearby areas. So there are so many colleges where we found only the assistant professors. Okay. So the question is that when we can we keep a percentage quota that 70% are from assistant professor, 20% from associate, 10% from professors? Yes. So when you fix the quota like this, depends upon the criteria. So then this sampling is known as quota convenience sampling or quota judgmental sampling. Because putting only the quota is not a quota sampling. So quota sampling should be followed by judgmental or convenience. The quota sampling is only putting the condition, because you know that in government we have quota system, just 50% general and this much percent SC, this much percent ST and OBC, like that. So similarly, we are putting the quota and depends upon the realistic scenario. Okay, so first you decide the quota, then you decide go for the judgmental or convenience. So the actual sampling method is quota judgmental and quota convenience. Now this is the last technique of non-probability sampling. And I'm telling you, in last 1 year after Corona, I found this technique hugely applicable by the researchers, the snowball sampling. So researchers say that, first of all, I make the list of the persons in my network who are satisfying the criteria. Right, for example, I want to collect the data from the Corona patients. So first of all, I will make a list that who was suffering from Corona patient, and I know them. So then I float my Google form to the link to the them and request them to fill the questionnaire. Then I request them to kindly forward this link to those people who are known, and they can fill the data. So this is a chain. So you send questionnaire to X and request him to send it further in different groups. So he will send the questionnaire in different WhatsApp group, different LinkedIn group, different Facebook groups, and say that if you are suffering from the Corona, kindly fill this questionnaire, like that. So you are sending the Google form to some known people. They will send to their known people. They will send to their known people. So it is a chain, right? And in academics, I'm telling you, this is very common, because I got a questionnaire from my teacher or my friend, and he asked me to fill the questionnaire and forward this questionnaire to other person who can fulfill the criteria. So this sampling is suddenly becomes a most important sampling and the most used sampling nowadays. So this sampling is known as snowball sampling, and I found no problem in using this sample. So snowball sampling is a systematic sampling method where you identify the list who are satisfying the criteria, and you ask them to fill the questionnaire, and even ask them, do you know somebody who is also fulfilling the criteria, and send the Google form to them. This is snowball sampling. Now we are moving to the list of different types of probability sampling. Probability sampling are those sampling where the probability of selection of each and everybody is equal. Because suppose I ask you, your boss is going to select one employee. So who will be sent to the Switzerland for getting the best training program? Now tell me, do you think you will be the employee which your boss will send? And in most of the answer I got is that no, sir, my boss will send to some favorite. It means the random sampling is not this. Random sampling means when your probability is equal to be selected. Like for example, if government is offering the houses to the lucky draw, and anybody can fill the form, and then after some day the government is going to announce the lottery system. Like in Delhi Development Authority DDA, they announces to sell the flats, right? There's a DDA schemes. And there are many people who want the house. They fill the forms and applied for the houses. And someday the DD announces the lottery and tell that these are the persons who came in the lottery. Now, if I ask you, so do you think you have probability to be in? And everybody say that yes, that meri lottery nikli. So everybody say that I can win. So this is a random sampling. Means your probability to be in is equal. So simple random sampling is the first method. In simple random sampling, I call it lottery system or lottery sampling. In the simple random sampling is a lottery sampling where the sampling units are drawn or selected by using some lottery method. So there are two types of lottery method. One is the manual lottery method. You can see this woman is picking up the chits, and whosoever is found in the chits will be selected. So this is manual lottery, but in research, manual lottery is not possible. So we do random selection method in Excel, or we apply some. You know that there are many functions of generating the random numbers, like rand between function. So normally we adopted the computerized random sampling. So we generate the random numbers, and whosoever is coming, we will select those. And the extension of the random sampling is systematic random sampling. In systematic random sampling, you pick first person by random sampling, and all other persons will be on systematic distance. Like for example, if there are 100 people in the population and you want to select any 10, so what you do, you divide 100 by 10, answer is 10. So in the first 10, you pick the number by random sampling. For example, 7 will come. So the first number between 1 and 10 is 7. Then all other number will be 17, 27, 37, 47, 67, like that. So the first number is selected on random, and all other numbers will coming in systematically. So this is known as the systematic random sampling. Like this, give you one example. There are 1 lakh elements in the population, and you need 1,000 in the sample. So in this case, the sampling interval is 100. Sampling interval means 1 lakh divided by 1,000, the sampling interval is 100. So in the first 100, you draw one unit, one, and suppose this is 23. So in the first 100, you draw any number and it is 23. It means all other number will be 123, 223, 323, 423, and 523. That's all. So this method is known as systematic random sampling. Okay. Now the stratified random sampling. In random sampling, we have two methods. One is stratified random sampling, and second sampling is known as the area random sampling or cluster sampling. And this stratified sampling and the random sampling have very simple concept. First of all, you have to decide that can we divide the target population on the basis of some demographic profile. Let's say I am dividing the faculties into three categories: assistant, associate, and professor. I divide my population into three groups: rich, the poor, and the middle class. So poor class, middle class, and the upper class. So I'm dividing it. Similarly, you can have some more classification. Sometimes we divide the population on the basis of MBA and non-MBA, or doctor and non-doctor, or businessman service class. So what happens? We divide the target population on the basis of some criteria. And most of the time, the criteria is on demographic profile. And we assume that the different class are homogeneous in nature. Let's say, if I ask you, can you say that the computer science BTech are different from mechanical BTech? Answer is yes. Can I say the computer class have some similarity in them? Answer is yes. Can I say there is some similarity in the mechanical BTech? Answer is yes. So like you say that MBA in marketing, MBA in finance, MBA in HR. So are they different from each other? Answer is yes. So, but I say, do you think that the marketing MBA students have some similarity? Answer is yes. Do finance students are having some similarity? Answer is yes. So some homogeneity is there in the different classes. So these classes are known as strata. So there is a word, and the word is known as strata. Strata means homogeneous subset. So we divide the population into homogeneous subset, homogeneous. So the word is homogeneous subset. And after that, you go for random sampling or systematic sampling. This is known as stratified random sampling. And the strata may be in the proportionate as per the real population, or it may be as disproportionate as to the random real population. So like, for example, you found that the rich class is only 10% or 20%, and the middle class is 50%, 40% is poor. So are you keeping that percentage in the sample or not? So that is called proportionate stratified sampling. And if you don't take care of this proportion, real proportion, then it is actually known as disproportionate sampling. Similarly, we are having cluster sampling. Now, the cluster means what? Cluster means area. So cluster means area. Like, for example, Delhi is divided into different clusters like North Delhi, West Delhi, East Delhi, or South Delhi. Similarly, you know that Chandigarh, Sector 1, Sector 2, Sector 3, Sector 4. Even Jaipur is divided into area, different areas. So when your city or when your state, so whatever be your target population, so if it can be divided into different areas, and then you select the respondent from different areas, this is called cluster sampling. In Delhi, I have seen this cluster sampling very frequently, because they say that we divide Delhi NCR into Delhi, Bahadurgarh, Faridabad, Gurgaon, Ghaziabad, Noida. So all comes in the Delhi NCR. And they say that according to the population, we pick 40% from the Delhi, we 20% from Noida, 10% from Gurgaon, Faridabad, Bahadurgarh, or so many other areas coming in Ghaziabad. So this division, that this much from Delhi, this much from Noida, this much from Ghaziabad, this much from Bahadurgarh, Faridabad. So this is called cluster sampling. Actually, you divide your target population into areas, some areas, and then you decide how many people we take from different areas. This is known as cluster sampling. Cluster sampling is applicable when you want to include different kind of heterogeneous groups in the population. Why I call heterogeneous? Because within the area, the population is heterogeneous. Like, for example, if I pick the sample from the Ghaziabad, can I say all the Ghaziabad people are same? No. There are many rich people in Ghaziabad. There are many poor people in Ghaziabad. So heterogeneity is there within the area. So within group heterogeneity is high, but in stratified, within group heterogeneity is low. So the difference between strata and cluster is that within group heterogeneity is high in cluster, within group heterogeneity is low in strata, right? So this is the basic difference between cluster and stratified sampling. Okay, so these are the strength and weakness of the different techniques. And at this point of time, the first portion of my lecture ends. The first portion focuses on few aspects, like what is the sampling process, what is the sampling frame, and what is the meaning of a statistical inference, like that. So now, after this, I will go to the next topic. The next topic is sample size determination. So I'm taking a 1 minute break. Just keep silence for 1 minute so that a new topic will come to your mind. Okay. So now I'm moving to the second part, and which is very, very dangerous part. And those who are doing the thesis or research, so they should be clear on this. The second part is the determination of the sample size. So there are many methods of, there are many principles, rules of determining the sample size. And every day, some new techniques are coming up. Even some softwares are also coming up. I will demonstrate two softwares for calculation of the sample size. So the sample size is based on three aspects. Number one, how much variance lies in the population. So what is the standard deviation of the population? So variance and the standard deviation are the same thing. Variance is the square of the standard deviation. So the first concept on which the population or sample size determination is based is the variability of the population. The second is that how much confidence level it is attached. So what is your confidence level? The confidence level may be 95% or 98%, 99%. And if I'm saying that my confidence level is 95%, it means there is the probability of doing mistake is 5%. And what is this mistake? The mistake is a rejection of a true hypothesis. So because we know that there are different type of error terms, type 1 error, type 2 error. So here we are talking about the type 1 error, right? So here we are committing the type 1 error. And what is type 1 error? The probability of rejecting a hypothesis when it is true. So this error is known as type 1 error. So if your confidence level is 95%, the type 1 error is assumed to be 5%. Then it is the allowable error or margin of error. So margin of error you have to define. So there are three things which you must know before deciding the sample size. And the basic formula on the basis of these three is this. So this is the most important formula and most common formula in calculation of the sample size. I'm showing you the example. In this formula, the Z value is actually constant and this value is always 1.96. Assuming the confidence level of 95%, the Z value is 1.96 and it is with 95%. And if your confidence level is 99%, the Z value is 2.58. It is a fixed value. So standard deviation is, most of the cases, is assumed to be 0.5. Or you can say it is a 50%. Because 50% standard deviation is quite high. And not very high, moderately high. So we assume that standard deviation is equal to 50%. And margin of error, this is margin of error. Margin of error is in most of the cases is to be keep at 5%. Right. So if you fill Z is equal to 1.96 and sigma is equal to 5.5 and margin of error is 5%, the N is always coming to be 384. So if you fill these values, the answer is always coming to be 384. Now in this problem, in this calculation, we cannot change the Z. We cannot change it because it is fixed value. Normally, we can also not change the error term because it is a fixed value. So there is only one variable which you can change, and that value is known as that sigma. So you can change the sigma according to the variability. So sometimes you can take the 0.4, sometimes you can take the 0.6. So if you decrease the sigma, the sample size will be less than, or it is coming around to be 300. Around. It is less than 384, it is coming to be 300. And if you increase the sample size, this standard deviation to the 0.6, the answer will be more than 400 something or 500 something. So let me show a small calculation to you. If I take the Excel, so it is a blank Excel file, and I'm saying that the Z is equal to 1.96. The standard deviation is 0.5. And let me increase this font size so that you can see it clearly. And the margin of error is 5%. That on the basis of this, the sample size will be equal to, so I'm putting a formula, this square multiplied by, this is Z square multiplied by standard deviation square and divided by the error square divided by the error square. So answer, as I told you, it is 384. This 384 is the magic number. It is a magic number of sample size determination. And why this is a magic number, I will tell you. So if I change my standard deviation is 0.4, so you can see that the sample size coming down from 384 to 245. So I have seen this game in most of the cases. They say that my variability is only 40%, so my sample size should be 284. Or if you have the sample size of 500, you change it to 0.6 and say that my there's a lot of variation in my data set. So I keep on increasing the sample size to 553. So this is one of the formula, most famous formula. I have seen most of the thesis, they describe this formula like this. So you can adjust this formula nearest to your sample size. Suppose your sample size is less than 200, then you can keep it 3. The answer is 138. Or you can keep it 0.35, so it is 188. So in this way, the manipulation is going on in the market. So you can make your formula near to your sample size. Okay, now the question is that this standard deviation, right? How to exactly calculate this standard deviation? How to exactly calculate the standard deviation? I asked this question to many people and they are giving me different answers. Because nobody knows that this is standard deviation of which thing, which variable, right? So everybody knows this formula, but they don't know ki standard deviation hai kiska. So I'm telling you the different answer. So some professors say that when we are doing the pilot survey, we calculate the standard deviation of this of the score of total variables, and we normally divide it by the scale. Like for example, if we are collecting the data on the 5-point scale, and after calculating the average standard deviation, we divide the standard deviation by the 5 and find out how much variation is there in the data. The reason is that the in books it is mentioned that it is a population standard deviation, but population standard deviation we don't know. So we assume that, so what is standard deviation comes from in the sample survey or in the pilot survey, that is the indication of the population standard deviation. So the market means the research scholars, the teachers, the evaluators. So they don't know. I have not found out any satisfactory answer of this, because I asked this question to many people and never got the satisfactory answer that how to find out the standard deviation. So we are manipulating the standard deviation calculation. So we say that it is the standard deviation of the responses in the pilot survey, and this is most of the received answer that I received from the different people. And question is, why this is the most appropriate answer? Because the population we never have. The population standard deviation we cannot calculate. So most of the time I'm getting this answer. Okay, I hope you have clarity. I'm telling you the pro and cons of each formula. This formula is most sought formula. Actually, in one of the panel interview, the panel member say to the scholar that you don't know the calculation of the sample size, come to me, I will tell you. So after that, the scholar got to the professor and asked her, please tell me. So professor told this formula. Then the student asks, sir, how can I calculate the standard deviation? And no answer. So these are the actual cases I found. Okay, now there are two more formulas. And this formula I found in medical science. Both, most of these two formulas, I have seen that the doctors are using these formulas very frequently, because in previous formulae, I'm using the standard deviation, and in this formula, I'm using the proportion. So in this formula, the first formula, you can see the Z square, I know it is the square of 1.96. The e square, I know because it is the square of 0.05. Now, what is p? P is the proportion. P is the proportion. Proportion of the population. Right. So, you know that if we assume that the 30% of the Indians have the blood pressure more than 1.140, so the proportion is 30%. And normally, if we know that how many people in India are poor, rich, upper class, how many are educated? So we know that the literacy of India is around 70%, something like that. So when we know these kind of proportions, we can use this formula. So I am showing you this formula, calculation part. So I am taking this formula in Excel. This is the formula. And so I am adding one feature here, P. So what is P? P is the proportion. And suppose the doctor is telling me that 30% of the public in India, they are lacking the vitamin D. So the P is 30%, or you can write 30% or points the same thing. Now this P is a valid P. Most of the time it is published in most of the reports that this much of the population is this, this much of the population is this. So if I came to know that 10% of the public is suffering from the diabetes, so P is 10%, like that. After that, I'm calculating the sample size. The formula is Z square multiplied by P. What is P? P is this. And what is Q? Q is 1 minus P, simple. 1 minus P. Right? So this is my numerator. And I divide it by denominator. E square B3 power 2. And can you tell me the answer? The answer is 245. No, 3, okay. So 322. If I change this formula to 50%, again we come back to the 384. So I told you that this is a magic number. And we decided each and everything from by this magic number. So if I keep 50%, the answer is 384. If this is 40%, the answer is 368. So the value comes below if you change the proportion. So I keep it 50% like this, and I will reduce to 20% if my sample size is around 245. So the proportion of the population is the key figure in this area. So in this formula, we are using the proportion population. After that, we are having another thing that if we don't know standard deviation, if we don't know the proportion, then what to use. So in this case, the formula is also there. If you don't know this P or sigma, still you can use the formula for calculating the standard deviation. So I'm showing you this also. This formula is my formula number 3. So formula number 3, the sample size, it is a universal sample size. If you don't know the standard deviation or the population proportion, so the answer is 1 upon 4 multiplied by z square into e square. So multiplied by z square means 1.96 square, and divided by E square means 0.5% square. So the answer comes 384. I told you that 384 was the magic figure. So 384 is a magic figure, and by default we call this number. So if your sample size is more than 384, I can tell you nobody can touch you. So because you can support, you can give so many supports for this 384. So we are having three basic formulas, and I'm giving some more methods in addition to this. Now there is one more concept called Nunnally principle. Nunnally principle. This Nunnally principle is highly quoted if you are applying EFA, CFA, and SEM, exploratory factor analysis, confirmatory factor analysis, and structural equation modeling. Then Nunnally principle is highly quoted. So Nunnally say that count the number of scale items in your questionnaire or in your model, right? So how many interval scale questions are there in the questionnaire? Suppose you are using 25 statements, which are measured in the scale of 1 to 5, 1 to 7. So Nandini says that just multiply by 10. So 250 multiplied by 10, sorry, 25 multiplied by 10. So the required sample size is 250. So the required sample size is 250. So this principle is known as Nandini principle, and it is highly quoted, cited principle I have seen in the research papers. So remember this, if you are going to apply CFA, EFSM or PLS, and if you are having only 25 items, 30 items, then multiply it by 10. So 30 multiplied by 10 is known as 300 is equal to 300. So you must have the sample size of 300. And if you are having this criteria, don't worry, Nunnally will save you. Then after the Nunnally principle, we are having the KMO estimate. This KMO estimate is calculated when you are doing the factor analysis. So KMO stands for Kerr-Meyer-Olkin. So the name is very difficult. So Kerr-Meyer-Olkin tell you the some criteria that if you calculate KMO of the all the interval scale items in the questionnaire, and if KMO is less than 0.5, it is not acceptable. And if KMO is greater than 0.5, not sufficient. So if you have KMO more than 0.7, this is also an indication that your sample size is sufficient. So KMO is the test of sampling adequacy. KMO is the test of sampling adequacy, because in most of the cases I found this KMO, and the scholar calculate the KMO and say that my KMO is more than 0.7. So I can say the sample is adequate. My sample is adequate. So this is one of the justification of your sample size. The next is the representative sample. In some book, like for example, there is a book called the Zygmunt. This is a world famous book, and the name of the title of the book is Business Research Methods. The author is Zygmunt, and so I must have this book near to my Almira. Yeah. So this book, I found that what he says about the sampling size. So he says that even if you ask the expert, you go to the experts, and the suppose experts say that you should take the sample size of 500, or the sample size of 600, or the sample size of 400. So ask the expert. So some if the experts say that 400 is sufficient, it means it is sufficient. So you must have some expert validation on the sample size. Ask to some experts and ask them how much sample size I should collect for my research. So it is also fine. Then I found that there is a table in the research, and they quote this table. So this table was calculated by Bartlett. So this is a Bartlett sample size determination table. I am showing you this table. Let me show you this table. If I type here Bartlett table of sample size, so this table will come. So you can see that this is a table, right? So you can see this table. So this table is very easy to access. And I cut and paste this table here. This is the table. Okay, now how to read this table, I'm just explaining you. Suppose your confidence level is 95%. So this table is determining the sample size on the basis of three criteria. The first criteria is your confidence level, which is 95%. The second criteria is margin of error, which is 5% in normal case, 5%, 3.5%, 2.5%, 1%, and your population size. So your population size. Now the most amazing thing you can find out that if your confidence level is 95% and if the margin of error is 5% and your population size is 3 crores. So 300 million, you can see that in the last value, 300 million. So which sample size is suitable? 384. It is a magic number. And I'm telling you, you can challenge that if my sample size is 384, so you have at least 5 supports to save you. And this Bartlett table is accepted all over the world. So nobody can challenge this table. So if your sample size is more than 384 and your population is up to 3 crores and your confidence level is 95, margin of error 5%, so this is one of the very strong support for your sample size. And you are in medical science or you are in any other area where your confidence level is 99%, and 99% with 5% margin of error, the sample size of 663 is sufficient. So sometimes the scholar says that my confidence level is 99%. So what should be my sample size? And the answer is 663. So these are the different supports of the sample size. Now I'm taking you to the another level. Okay. So this is one more. After this, we will discuss another thing. In most of the cases, I found that the Nunnally principle don't work because sometimes if you are collecting the data from the senior department heads of the company, then collecting the data is very tough. If you are collecting the data from the entrepreneurs, the 50 entrepreneurs is very high in number. So there is a person, the Bentler and Chow. The Bentler and Chow found that they criticize the Nunnally principle and say that 10 times is too much. So they say that if your data is normally distributed, if you have the 5 times sample size, right? If your sample size is 5 times, then the number of items, it is sufficient. So according to the Bentler and Chow, if data is normally distributed, the minimum sample size requires is 5 cases for each skill variable. For example, in a research study, if 50 variables are included, then minimum sample size of 250 is needed. So this is also a criteria, and the paper he wrote is in 1987. So I could write here the Bentler and Chow 1987, and yesterday I found this paper also in the net. So most of the scholars, they quote this Bentler and Chow criteria. Then we have another formula, 1-4 formula. And a scholar asked me, sir, that we also have a formula that is Slovin and Yamin formula. So Slovin gave this formula, and the formula is n upon 1 minus 1 plus n square. So this formula is used. And actually, this formula is similar to the formula that 1 upon 4 is n square e square. And in what circumstances we can apply this formula is that when you don't have any idea about the population, which is true in most of the cases, when you don't have any idea about the population, you can use this formula, the n upon 1 plus n e square, right? But n is the population size. So I'm trying also to apply this formula. This is the third formula we can use to calculate the sample size, and let me show you this. So in this case, the information which you require is the capital N, means the size of the population. Suppose you have the size of the target population, not the actual population, target population. Suppose the size of the target population is 2 lakhs. 2 lakhs, right? So it should be number. Yeah. So we have the population of 2 lakhs. So what should be the sample size? This is the Slovin formula. So Slovin say that the sample size divided by 1 plus the sample size multiplied by the error square. So you will get the answer, and answer is around 384. So Slovin formula is the formula which you can also apply if you have the idea about your population size. So this formula is also applied, and this formula was later on given by the Yamine. But still, the formula is named as Slovin formula. So this is another formula which we used to determine the sample size. Okay. Now I'm taking to you the another science, another area of the sample size, Okay. So the all the previous formulas have different inputs. Now there's a new area, there's a new technique which is coming up. And this technique is known as statistical power and the effect size. And there are some softwares like GPower is the software which is used by the scholars to justify their sample size. But GPower is software. I will demonstrate this software. So this software depends upon the statistical power, the concept of statistical power and the concept of effect size. So I have to explain what is the statistical power and what do you mean by the effect size. Okay. Now, in previous cases, we are using the concept of confidence level. And confidence level is normally 95%. And confidence level is calculated on the basis of the type 1 error. Now, that is separate thing. Now, we are moving to the type 2 error. So, what is type 2 error? If you see this red box, in this red box, the alpha and beta are represented like this. And this is the null hypothesis when it is true and when it is false. And this is the accepted, null hypothesis accepted, and this is null hypothesis rejected. So we have this alpha and beta. Okay. So in the first dot, this is the first dot, and this is the second dot. So in first dot, we are accepting the true hypothesis and there is no problem in it. It is a correct decision. In second dot, we are rejecting the false null hypothesis. It is a true decision and it is no problem at all. So we did two mistakes in the research. One is alpha, this is called type 1 error. And beta, this is called type 2 error. Alpha means the probability of rejecting a true hypothesis. And beta, the probability of accepting a false hypothesis. Right? Like suppose, I'm giving you an example. Suppose you go to the sweet shop to buy the sweet. And if you reject a good quality sweet, this is called type 1 error. And if you buy a bad sweet, this is called type 2 error. Right? So this is now the statistical power is based on the type 2 error. Right? It is based on type 2 error because everybody was looking from this angle alpha. Now we are looking at the second angle beta. So probability, what is the statistical power? So I'm that explaining you. The accuracy in doing the removing the type 2 error, or in general I can say the probability that a test will correctly reject a false null hypothesis. The probability that a test will correctly reject a false null hypothesis is known as statistical power. So power is equal to 1 minus type 2 error. So like that, alpha is equal to 1 minus confidence level. The first dot is representing you the confidence level. And second dot is representing you the power. So what is power? 1 minus type 2 error. So we are minimizing the type 2 error in this case. So I repeat, the statistical power of a test can be defined as the accuracy in rejecting a false hypothesis. Right? So more intuitively, statistical power can be stated as the probability of accepting an alternate hypothesis when the alternate hypothesis is true. Okay. Now the criteria, how much statistical power we want. So like we want the confidence level as 95%. So similarly, we also want the statistical power of 95% and minimum requirement is 80%. So I hope you understand what is the statistical power. Statistical power is the second dot. Accuracy of the second dot in simple language. So the accuracy of taking this second dot decision is called statistical power. And the next concept which come is that two type of power analysis. So when we do this power analysis, we do two times. So we do the statistical power two times before collecting the data and after collecting the data and after applying the test. So first of all, a priori means if you are going to collect the data, then a priori determination is required. Determination means the a priori means determining the sample size before the data collection. And post hoc means after the data collection. So once you collected the data and applied the test, now you are interested to find out the power. That what is the power of my test? And after that, so basically this is statistical power based on, depends upon the three aspects. The alpha, which is normally 5%, effect size, and the sample size used to estimate the effect size. So we want the power to be maximum so that the accuracy will be high. And I'm saying that the power depends upon the sample size. So now we can also say our sample size should be such that the statistical power should be 95%. So this is the another way of looking at the sample size. Now here, I think the power you know very well, the accuracy in making the, in rejecting a false null hypothesis, the effect size. Now what is the effect size? And so effect size is determining only on the basis of two concepts. Effect size is calculated by two methods. Number one, the difference. Number two, the correlation, right? Like for example, if I want to know that what is the difference in the marks obtained by the female student and male student, so that difference is the effect size. So in effect size, actually, you know that in medical science, they have control group, experimental group. So the standardized difference between the difference of the mean, the difference of the mean of control group and experimental group is the effect size. Similarly, when you apply the regression model or the correlation model or the SAM model or the DLS model, the correlation is the effect size. So sometimes the status, the sample size determination depends upon the what? Effect size. So if you are going to apply the t-test ANOVA test, then your sample size will be determined by the t-test ANOVA test. If you are going to apply the SAM model or PLS model, then the sample size is based on the correlation value. So these are the inputs for calculating the sample size. Okay. Now there are two, I'm demonstrating you two softwares. One is the G-Power and second is the Daniel software. And the reason of demonstrating is that because they are, everybody is using them. So you should know how to use these two ways. So first of all, I'm going to the Google and I'm typing here Daniel Super. And this Daniel Super will give me the sample size calculation. So suppose I go for this calculator a priori sample. Okay. Now the calculator is coming. So if you see the a priori means before going to collect the data. So this is the method of calculating a priori sample size calculator for structural equation models. So this calculator will compute the sample size required for the study that uses a SAM model. Given the number of observed and latent variable in the model, the anticipated effect size and the desired probability and the statistical power level. So if you give the input, the software will give you the effect size. Now I'm telling you, so how much effect size you are anticipating? And I told you the effect size is the correlation, right? And there are three types of effect size, low, moderate, and strong. So if you click on the question mark, the software is telling you the minimum absolute anticipated effect size for SAM is 0.1, 0.3, and 0.4, 0.5, sorry. So we cannot assume that you will get very strong statistical effect size. So I will click on the three because my hypothesis, with the hypothesis which I want to test with the help of SAM model, is assumed to have moderate effect. So I assuming the moderate effect size, I am putting 0.3. A statistical power you require, 0.8 is the minimum. We have to assume it 0.95. It is the minimum desired statistical power. And now you have to tell that how many items I have in the data, in the model or in the questionnaire. Suppose you say that I have 30 items in the questionnaire. So number of 30 items I have, let's say make it 60, because at the most you are having the 60 item. Then how many latent variables are there in the model? Like, for the latent variable means how many constructs you are measuring, how many factors you are measuring. Suppose I am measuring 10 factors with the help of 60 items and my probability is 5%. Then what is my sample size? Calculate. You just click on the calculate and the software will tell you the sample size should be, the minimum sample size to detect defect is, minimum sample size for model structure is 1027. So the minimum sample size is this, but actually it is too high. So let me reduce it to 40. So what could be the sample size? Now 991. So this software, it will give you the scientific method of calculating the sample size. If you give, if you assume all these things, so if you assume the low effect size, then the sample size will always come down. Now it is 991, and recommended minimum sample size is this. And if so, if you change these values, you will get different sample size like this. And it, if you decrease the statistical power to 80%, the sample size further will come down. So, okay, this is the method of calculating sample size. And if you want to give the reference, so you click on this, and the software is telling you that if you want to quote this calculation, you can use this reference for giving this calculator. So it is Soper DS, Daniel Soper, 2021. This is the citation of sample size, right? And this sample size is not only available for SAM. You are having another methods of calculation of the sample size. I'm showing you that. Okay, so you have, if you go to the back, so if you want to find out the sample size for multiple regression, you can do, you can calculate from here. A prior sample size calculated for multiple regression, you can click on this. A student t-test, you can click on this. So there are different, so this is the calculator for multiple regression model. Like in multiple regression model, effect size is the beta slope coefficient. If it is 20, the statistical power is 80, number of predicted, number of independent variable is 3, and calculate. So the effect size, the minimum required sample size is 59. And if I increase the statistical power, this size will increase. The sample size will increase and it is now 90. So if you are applying the multiple regression model in your thesis or paper, so you can tell the justification of the sample size by giving this calculator. So this is the, this software is known as Daniel Soper, Daniel Soper. And it is the latest, because you know that the quotation, the citation is 21. So if you want to cite it, so it is 21. So this is just a latest happening for calculating the sample size. Now I'm showing you the another method. Okay. So there is a software, you can see the software. The name of the software is G-Power. So when you open the software, the software comes like this. And you can use this G-Power software to